Hello everyone, Teagan here with High Point. Thank you so much for tuning in once again to What is in the Night Sky this month, December edition. Tonight I'm going to be taking you through a beautiful tour of the night sky on the month of December. We're going to be traveling out of our solar system, visiting some deep sky objects, and then we're also going to discuss a few phenomena that will be happening within our own solar system. So you will not want to miss this. As always, buckle in and let's see what's really out there. Now, there are going to be a lot of phenomena happening within our own solar system this month. So first, we're going to talk about the Geminid meteor shower. When it comes to meteor showers, many amateur astronomers rank the Geminids above the Perseids. They may be fainter, but they rival the Perseids in number. Gemini also rises earlier and higher than Perseus. This year's shower promises to put on a good show. The moon is at last quarter and therefore will not rise until around 11 p.m., giving you a good 3 to 4 hours of darkness to spot some shooting stars. They can appear almost anywhere, but with Gemini rising in the east, your best chance is to probably look towards the southeast or northeast. Now here at High Point, we get many questions like what's the best equipment to use to view a meteor shower, binoculars, or a telescope, when in fact, nothing at all. You want to view the meteor shower in the darkest location possible with your naked eye. Now the Geminid meteor shower occurs on December 13th through the 14th, but a week before that, the opposition of Mars occurs on December 7th. Mars reaches opposition every 2 years or so, and this year it occurs in the constellation of Taurus. Its coppery light is comparable to Aldebaran, the constellation's brightest star, but at magnitude negative 1.9, it easily outshines its stellar rival. At its best, Mars can appear 25 arc seconds in apparent diameter, but this year it'll only reach 17. While this isn't ideal, it still presents a good opportunity for telescopic observers to seek dark markings on its surface and the star-like glint of the planet's polar ice caps. This year, however, there is an added bonus. The moon turns full the same evening and will appear to occult the planet by passing in front of it. This event will be visible from much of North America, but those on the East Coast and the Southeast will miss out. While the exact details may vary depending on your location, Mars will disappear sometime between 9:30 and 11 p.m. We are going to leave our solar system now, and we're going to visit a couple double clusters and a variable star. First, we're going to start off with the incredible open cluster, the Hyades. While you're observing Mars, please take a moment to enjoy the nearby Hyades star cluster. Representing the head of Taurus the Bull, this V-shaped cluster is a fine sight for both naked eye and binocular observers. Aldebaran, the star that marks the red eye of the bull, appears on the edge of the cluster, but it isn't actually a true member of the cluster. It lies at a distance of 67 light years, whereas the cluster itself lies about 80 light years further away. The star merely appears within the same line of sight, but without it, the cluster would be much less distinctive. Now we move on from this gorgeous open cluster to a variable star, known as Algol. We have talked about Algol in the past, but of all the variable stars in the night sky, Algol is by far the easiest to observe. Every 2.9 days, its brightness dips from magnitude 2.1 to 3.4 for 10 hours, making it a favorite with naked eye observers. In reality, Algol is a multiple star system, and its drop in magnitude is caused by the fainter star eclipsing its brighter companion. Now we're going to move on to Messier 77, a galaxy discovered by Charles Messier himself. Winter is a season dominated by star clusters, but there are a few galaxies to be glimpsed. Messier 77 in Cetus is detectable with binoculars, but you will need a telescope to get the most out of it. Small scopes show a misty oval with a bright core that extends about halfway to the galaxy's edge. Larger scopes of 10 inches of aperture or more can show some texture and hints of the galaxy's spiral arms. Now moving on from our list of deep sky objects, we are going to bring it closer to home and see what the moon and the planets are up to. There is a rare opportunity to see every planet in the evening sky this month. Mercury appears low in the southwest from about 15 minutes after sunset, with Venus remaining to its lower right throughout the month. A crescent moon joins the pair on December 24th. Time is running out to see Saturn as it's rapidly sinking in the southwest after sunset. You can find a beautiful crescent moon to its left on December 26th. As for Uranus and Neptune, they both remain visible in the evening throughout the entire month. Both are moving among faint stars and will require binoculars, with Uranus roaming the southern stars of Aries and Neptune in Aquarius. After reaching opposition in October, Jupiter remains a brilliant sight in Pisces, with the first quarter moon appearing to its upper left on the 29th. December, however, belongs to Mars. It will reach opposition on the 7th, the moon will turn full on the 7th, and will occult Mars for much of North America. The moon then turns new on the 23rd. So that is it for our tour of the night sky in the month of December. If you stayed along with us, we thank you so much for joining us on our tour tonight. If you have any questions, please let us know in the comments. And if you plan to view the occultation of Mars, please let us know. It's going to be an incredible event, again, on December 7th. That being said, like our video, subscribe to our YouTube channel so you do not miss any of our future content. Thank you so much, and as always, clear skies.